welcome to the video. All glory, honor, and praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms or the heavenly places in Christ Jesus our Lord. Today I'm going to be talking about 10 types of pastors or teachers just to take notice of. I started to do this video yesterday and then the video went in another direction. But I was talking about how when I first got saved, I was looking for pastors that I could learn from. And you know, when you first get saved, not everybody, but when some people get saved, they think that anyone saying the name of Jesus Christ is of God. And you think that because you're fresh and new, you're excited, you've come into knowledge of the truth, you know about Jesus now, you've been cleansed of your sins, and so you're trying to connect with other people that have had your experience. And so anyone saying Jesus, people start to feel like or believe that, all right, they're like me, or they're zealous to want to connect with them or learn from them. But as you go through your journey, you'll realize that the Bible says narrow is the way and straight is the gate and few there be that find it. And there are a lot of people that are not teaching correctly. There are a lot of people that are not representing correctly. And I spoke about this yesterday, but everybody starts off good. Not everybody, but a lot of people, when they first get saved, they start off good. So a lot of the pastors that now people probably shouldn't watch, when they first started out, they were just like any of us. They were just like, they were zealous. They had been born again. They had been walking the narrow path. They were living a righteous life. And then somewhere along the line, deception comes, trickeries come, the enemy's tricks come, and people are deceived for one reason or another. And that's why I was saying it's so important that we recognize our need for God, is because great and small men, short and tall men, weak and strong men, smart and less intelligent men, have all been deceived throughout the course of history. Some of the smartest minds on the planet Earth are deceived until this day. A lot of our great scientists, a lot of the, I don't want to say our, but a lot of the great scientists in the world, a lot of the great merchants and businessmen, the people that have written books and done all kind of genius things that have great vocabularies and are well studied, a lot of these people are deceived. They're learned about the wrong things. We have doctors and astrophysicists who have went to school for 8, 10, 12 years, however long, and they've learned a bunch of lies. And they're super intelligent, super gifted, super well informed about things that are not true, about things that are against God. And so just got to be mindful of that. And that could happen to anyone if they're not covered, if they're not protected, if you know, by God. So part of us, the Lord tells us to pray, keep us away from temptation and deliver us from evil, because we need God to keep us from temptation. No one's smart enough, right, on their own to be kept away from temptation. There's always someone smarter. There's always a deception that somebody won't see. And without God's grace and God's mercy, it could happen to anybody. So I pray and I encourage you guys to pray. And we all pray as the Lord taught us to pray. Keep us from temptation and deliver us from all evil, Father. Keep us away from temptation, because we need help being kept from temptation and deception. You know, I had a conversation with a brother of mine months ago. And this is one of the pastors that I'll get into, actually. But and one of the types of pastors to watch out for. But my brother, he was doing really good on his path, walking with the Lord. And then somebody calls him with a deception saying, hey, you gotta, and he didn't know about it at the time. He wasn't informed. You gotta call Jesus Yeshua. You're not supposed to call him Jesus. That's not the real name. The letter J wasn't invented until 1524. So those who are calling on the name of Jesus Christ is deceived. The name Jesus means something pig in Latin and all these things. And he started to believe it. So here we have a young Christian man, newly saved, on fire for God, preaching the gospel, seeking God, doing his what he feels he's called to do as a believer. And he gets a phone call from a relative that tells him a deception. And because he's not informed about it, or knows about it, it sounds good, it sounds true. The letter J was invented in 1524. I can't deny this. I can Google it and find all the facts and information that's true. But here, there goes the deception. And so by the grace and mercy of God, for us both, for my brother that I love and for him and everyone else, I called him shortly after that time. And this topic somehow came up. I had helped somebody else with the same issue. I told him my testimony. And he was like, hey, brother, I've been using that name too. And then he went through a very deep deliverance from that as well. So that to God's glory, right? That even though he may have believed something that was false, within a week or two or however long it was, help was sent. A way was provided to get him out of that so that he didn't go any further deeper into it. So praise be to God, our Father, and our Lord Jesus Christ. All right, so that's the first pastor to watch out for, guys, is the Yeshua pastor, the one that makes a habit of using both the names Jesus and Yeshua. They'll pray and say, they'll combine both the names. They'll be telling a ministry, well, Jesus Yeshua said, love your neighbor. Jesus Yeshua said, they're combining two different names. And it's because that's double-mindedness. It's like, all right, they're leaning toward this Hebrew way, but they've been using the name of Jesus their whole life, so they can't really let Jesus go because they've been praying in the name of Jesus their whole life. And if Jesus isn't the name, then that would have to mean that their entire connection with God was a lie their whole life. And now they're finally getting it with the name Yeshua. Although we've all seen demons cast, not all, but many of us have seen or experienced demons being cast out in the name of Jesus, the sick being healed in the name of Jesus, the dead being raised in the name of Jesus, miracles and signs happening all in the name of Jesus Christ. Many of these same people that are now calling on Yeshua and Yahushua and Yahushua and all these other so-called paleo-Hebrew names were born again using the name of Jesus Christ. They had their first radical transformation. They got delivered. They got cleansed. They was on fire for God. Their relationship with God was established. And then someone comes along with a deception that makes them question and deny the entire experience that happened before them. So that anyone saying that, it's not that they may not know as well, but that's the beginning of deception. When people start mixing those names, it'll start with Jesus Yeshua, or it'll start with Jesus and Yeshua just sometimes. And then it's Jesus Yeshua, and then it's just majority Yeshua. And people are calling on the name that God has not given us to call on to, because that's not the language that you speak. That's not the name in the Bible that you have, right? To deny the name of Jesus Christ is to say that God has allowed millions, if not billions, of people to be deceived who speak the English language. Before the invention of the internet, where this information was readily available, before Hebrew was resurrected as a language in the 1800s, and no one was using these quote-unquote Hebrew names because Hebrew wasn't even a widely known language at that time. You can look up an article on the National Geographic about Hebrew being a dead language for 2,000 years. So for the last 1,000 or some odd years, however long English has been around, people have been saying the name of Jesus Christ, the whole world has been deceived. And God has just sat back and just watched us be deceived, and no one knows the name of his son by which we could be saved. And it denies that God doesn't want anyone to perish, but all to come to repentance. But in his sovereignty, for thousands of years, we've had a false name. It's a rejection of many things, and it's just incorrect. So that's the pastor to watch out for. He may not be all the way in the wrong direction, but he's headed in the wrong direction, you know? So we have to be careful. The Bible says a little leaven leavens the whole loaf. Right. And so sometimes a false belief, even though it may not be a major one, can open the door for other false beliefs, because now you're putting faith in the internet and research. So there's a whole host of things on the internet. There's a whole host of things you're going to find on internet research that you should not put your faith in. But now that you're leaning toward putting your faith in the internet instead of God's word that you've been given, who knows what else potentially you may look at it from the internet and believe you should apply to your life. That happens with the pastor. And I'll talk about this pastor, the woman pastor, you guys know. The pastor people should be aware of, even the pastors that approve of women pastors, because they are denying the word of God. They are denying the word of God, you know. So I would say be careful with that as well. As far as learning from them and watching them and learning from them, be careful of that as well, because they're reading the Bible and deciding that they read on the internet on a hermeneutic website that, oh, back 2,000 years ago, because of how things were happening in the Greek nations, or how things were happening in Rome, that's why Paul said that. But it wasn't supposed to be for our time. It was only for back then. And they'll start believing these internet lies that no one can back, can verify, or prove. And that one deception, which may not be as major as others, can open the door for other deceptions, because now you're believing in things that are not written, but things that you're finding from sources that are not even verified, and you're teaching it to your congregation. The next pastor people should be careful about is the fashion guru. Nothing wrong with dressing nice, nothing wrong with having nice clothes. But there are certain people out there that I see make more of an emphasis on being fresh and being fly than presenting the unadulterated word of God, right? Nothing wrong with being fashionable, nothing wrong with being fresh. I do think the Bible tells us to be modest, though, meaning that when we're going to church, when we're going to gather with other believers, we're not going to a party necessarily. We're not going to a fashion show. We're going to serve God. So the Bible tells women to not braid their hair or adorn themselves with fine clothing and jewelry. I don't think that means they can't wear that outside of church if they happen to have it, and you know, but not to be going to church to show off your fashion, to show off your nice clothes, to show off what you have. We're going to church to gather with the body of believers to worship God, to focus, not to be distracted by somebody's high fashion clothing or jewelry or earrings, or bring the attention on man instead of on God. And so when somebody's, it's nothing wrong with fashion, but it's like when it's just like, all right, it's always high fashion, it's always these high fashionable clothes, it's putting the focus on the person and their swag and their style and not on the word of God, which we came here to focus on if we're coming to church to gather with other believers. So that's the next pastor you should watch out for is the long hair pastor. As you know, the Bible says it is a shame for a man to have long hair. Paul says, don't you know that nature teaches you? It is a shame for man to have long hair. It is a disgrace to him if a man has long hair. That's in 1 Corinthians 11. And so, again, it's not that it's necessarily a sin, but it's people that are choosing a shallow, I guess, or a superficial attribute that is not needed, that the Bible actually calls disgraceful, and it has no particular regard for that statement. I would think if somebody's reading the Bible and it says it's disgraceful for a man to have long hair, a man will look at himself and say, man, so why do I have it? It's just hair. I should just cut this hair then. Like, why am I carrying something around that's disgraceful? There's also the false images of Jesus Christ out there that are portraying a false image of Christ, of a man with long hair. And the Bible says it's disgraceful for a man to have long hair. So you know that those images are clearly false for several reasons, but that being one of them. The next pastor you should watch out for, or just people in general, is the one that's always wearing shades. When I was growing up, and even till this day, I've always been a little cautious of men that are always hiding their eyes. And this may seem superficial, but I think there's something to it. When people are doing deliverance, you can look into somebody's eyes when they're manifesting, and there are times where you can see a change and a shift inside their eyes when they're fully manifesting and a demon is speaking through them. And so this is just a personal thing, and I've seen, I feel like when I see a guy with shades and I look in their eyes, they're hiding something in their eyes. It's not a guarantee. Again, none of these things are guarantees, but these are just things to be mindful of. If somebody's always wearing shades, I'm not talking about somebody that just has on shades sometimes or outside, but if somebody's always hiding their eyes, I personally believe it speaks to something else. It speaks to they're hiding something. They're trying to protect their eyes. They don't want someone to see in their eyes. That doesn't mean that that's the reason they're doing it. But in my experience, when somebody's always wearing shades, they're wearing shades wherever, anytime you see them, they always have shades on. It's, again, not a guarantee, but it's just something to be mindful of. I saw someone recently on Facebook that majority of their pictures, they have shades on. And then the pictures that they don't, I was looking at their eyes, and it could be me, but it seemed to be like something was there. The next person to be watched out for is the free gracer. I've talked about this topic a lot. There are people that teach that you can sin woefully because all you have to do is believe in Jesus Christ. You don't have to do any works and you're going to be saved. And it's not that you have to do works. And works and not sinning are two different things anyway. Jesus says, be perfect for your Father in heaven is perfect. Jesus told the adulterous woman to sin no more. He told the guy that he healed, sin no more or else something worse will happen to you. He commands us to repent or we will perish. The Bible says that we are not to continue in sin so grace may abound. The Bible talks that we can be cut off, that we can believe in vain, right? That many will say to me, Lord, Lord, and I will say, I never knew you, you workers of lawlessness. And then John says that sin is lawlessness in 1 John 3. And so we have to be keepers and practitioners of the word of God. The Bible talks about the fornicator, the adulterer, the extortioner, and others that are going to be thrown into the lake of fire. So anyone teaching that or not preaching against sin at all, if every sermon is just, and I'm going to get into the motivational speaker pastor too, but if every sermon is just this, it's this just about what you're going to be blessed with and God's plan for you, which is great. And that's good too. But if there's never a preaching against sin, if there's never a preaching of repentance, that's something you want to watch for. How often does your pastor preach repentance? How often does he teach people that they have to repent, that they have to confess, that they have to renounce and disassociate from things of this world that are dishonoring and that God doesn't approve of? Right? I would say watch out for that. The next pastor I would say watch out for is the marriage guru. Now, the Bible talks about marriage. A good amount of times, but I've seen a pattern of certain people that every single time they talk about God, they're not talking about God. They're not preaching about Christ. They're talking about marriage. They're talking about love and husbands and wives, and which is, the Bible touches on that. So it's important to talk about for pastors and everyone else. But where is the teaching about from Scripture? Where's the knowledge of the sacrifice and the resurrection? Where's the preaching of repentance? Where's the teaching of the spiritual matters that people are plagued with today? Yeah, marriage may be one of them. But what about the range of things that Christians are dealing with, right? The weapons of the enemy that are against Christians, the things happening in this world that people are against. I mean, that are against the body of Christ. What about the preaching of spiritual warfare? You know, what about these principles? If every time somebody's talking, it's about marriage, then marriage, yes, we are the bride of Christ. Married, God loves marriage. God gave us marriage, and we're going to be married to the Lord. But there are also a wider range of topics to talk about, right? And so if we're going to preach the word, people are suffering from a lot more things than just marriage. So a wider range of topics is important as well on other important points. The next kind of pastor, I didn't write this one down, but I'm going to say it now, that you should watch out for, is the pastor who did not speak against or did take the solution. And you know what I'm talking about. If I say that the solution, it starts with a letter V and ends with a letter N. That was going around a couple years ago, and they wanted you to take several of them and get boosted and all kind of other things. So that was clearly a 100% a weapon of the kingdom of the enemy. And so those who were leading congregations and told them to take it, and or told them it's up to you if you take it, and or didn't tell them not to take it. Not that that's a guarantee. Again, none of these are guarantees, but it's just something to be mindful of. I think that's an important question these days to ask any pastor, is what's your position on that? Because that was clearly, I know it's kind of disappeared now. The effects are lingering and remaining, but the actual work of it has disappeared. I know that the actual talking about it is starting to go away, but it's still an important question to ask. If you were a pastor in 2019, 20, and 21, like, what did you tell them concerning this thing? And even if you happen not to know, or you happen to be misinformed, have you repented? Have you, now that you've come into knowledge about it, came back to your congregation and said, hey, I was incorrect about this. We have to repent. Or have you just let it go and people are still being plagued and afflicted by this today? Okay, so that's another one to watch out for. The next type of pastor to watch out for is the motivational speaker. I'm sure you guys know various motivational speaking pastors out there. That it's always about how you're going to prosper, how you're going to be blessed, how you're going to be motivated, what you're going to do, what you're going to accomplish, the plan that God has for you, which is great. God has plans for us. God wants us to prosper and do well. That's great. But again, what did Jesus preach? Jesus preached repentance. Jesus preached turning the other cheek. Jesus preached not looking at a woman with lust. Jesus preached righteousness, and he preached repentance. So we're followers of Jesus Christ. We have to teach what Jesus taught. Jesus wasn't spending his entire ministry talking about the beautiful plan God has for any of us, right? God has a plan for us, of course, but some people are not going to see tomorrow, right? So they need to hear a message of repentance, because they might not have this glorious plan in this life, but they may have one in the next life. But they need to know about repentance today that they can have that glorious plan in the next life. So that's something important to be aware of. The next pastor to be aware of is the God told me pastor. There's a pastor that every day they're saying what God told them. God, prophecy is real. God talks to his people. God can give people dreams. God can talk to people. He can do whatever. God is sovereign. He can do as whatever he decides to do. But if somebody's every day they're saying what God told them, and then their message isn't even lining up with Scripture all the way, but God told them that, I would be aware of the God told me pastor. That every time they're saying, yesterday God told me this, then today God told me that. Just something to be watchful for. Yes, God could have indeed told the pastor something. He can be relaying it to his congregation. But if it's just constant and always that, that's something that I'd be mindful of. 100% the God told me pastor. The next pastor to be mindful of is the Greek and Hebrew Septuagint pastor. The pastor that uses hermeneutic breakdowns of the Greek language to subvert the clear, express meaning of Scripture. or sometimes they're just using it to sound smart or intelligent. They don't even speak Greek, but they can go and open up a Septuagint and read that ego in me. They can read the word and make it seem like they're more informed about the scripture when the plain reading of the scripture says what it says. I tell people that the people that translated this Bible into English were Greek scholars. So unless you speak Greek, I'm going to take what they translated plainly in English over what you're saying, unless you're not only do you speak Greek, but unless you are a Greek scholar yourself. And through your Greek scholarship, not your Google research, can I consider what your opinion against theirs? It still doesn't mean you're correct, but I can consider your opinion in scholarship if you're a Greek scholar. All right, so the last type of pastor to watch out for, the celebrity pastor is one, but the sensationist. And this is those who deny the power of God, who believe that the gifts of the Holy Spirit are no longer with us today. That's extremely dangerous. It is wrong, and it is not of God. And so the Bible says, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, you shall receive power from on high. So we are called to walk in power today, just as the apostles did yesterday. That's it for the day, guys. Thank you guys for tuning in. All glory, honor, and praise to our God and Father and to the Lord Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Thank you guys for tuning in. Bless you guys. If anybody wants to contribute or donate to the channel, you can do so in the link in the description box below. Peace and love, guys.